chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. Shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever
forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned.
because you died and rose again. Amazing love.
Rock this popsicle stand? Is that a thing? All right. Welcome to church, everybody. It's awesome to see you all this morning. Let's do this. Let's stand up this morning as a church. And I'm so excited to worship our God this morning. I'm so, so excited. This first song we're going to sing is very simple. We just ask that our Lord this day would be lifted up and he would be lifted higher than anything else in our lives, that we would put God at the forefront of our lives and that nothing would be higher than our Lord, our God. So let's sing this together. One, two.
Inside me, hope inside me. Ooh, your
Let our praises, let them fill the temple. Let this place be filled with our song to our God. Just sing, let our praises fill the temple.
So let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple. You are good.
Sing, let our praises.
Oh, so let our praises fill the temple. And let our praises fill the temple. And let our praises fill the temple. For you are good. Oh, yeah. Be lifted up. Oh, be lifted. Be lifted higher.
That the highest you would welcome. I was lost, but he brought me in, oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the sun said,
child.
time in my Father's house.
In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
I'm glad you can be here to share that with us. And let's go to the Lord. Let's pray this morning. Just thank Him for this great privilege that we have to be here an hour earlier than we normally are. Amen? No, I didn't think so. I don't know about you, but I struggled a little bit when the alarm went off this morning. But that's okay. We'll make it up in the fall, and we get all this nice spring weather coming. Let's pray together this morning. Lord Jesus, we just thank You today. For the blessing of who You are, and this morning our heart's desire is just to lift You up and to worship You. You're God. There's nobody like You. There's nobody who we know who can even come close to who You are. There's nothing too hard for You. You're all-powerful, Lord. You are beyond what we can think or what we can imagine. And we're kind of blown away, God, because You're all of those things. And yet You care for us. And You care for us, not just big picture, Lord. You care for us intimately, and You care for us personally. And Father, for that, I'm so thankful. Lord, this morning I pray that each word that is said, each song that is sung, Lord, we would just from our hearts really be thinking about You and who You are, and that this would be a way for us just to praise You together this morning. Where we can praise You together through the week on our own, but there's something special that happens when we come together as a church. And this morning, I pray that You would be honored and glorified with Your church here in this place today. Lord, just bless. Bless as we worship You through our give. Bless as we continue to sing songs to You. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I just invite you to remain standing as we worship some more.
and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free, I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Can see the love in your eyes. myself down, raising up the broken to life.
You take our failure.
You take our failure. You take our weakness. You set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel. The world to see your life in me.
Amazing grace.
Amazing grace. How sweet saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love.
Sing that one more time. I can see you now.
Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes. Laying yourself down. Raising up the broken to
that's awesome. Thank you, and be seated. And at this time, we'll dismiss the children for Children's Church. It's awesome to be here today, and I get excited every Sunday, and I hope you do too. Wow, so cool to get to come to church and worship. So cool to get to worship with you. I enjoy that every week. We are, this morning, we're looking at kind of revisiting our purpose and revisiting the reason that why we are here and why we are a church. And we know that a couple years ago, a year and a half ago, we began to kind of this process of refocusing. And it's very easy to kind of get into a rut. And I feel like that for me personally, that was guilty of doing that. And I began to feel like we were kind of just going through the motions. And listen, our relationship with God and church is not something that's worthy of just going through the motions. It's worthy of so much more than that. So we began to look at why we're here, what our purpose is, and we're going to kind of revisit some of that this morning. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 34, it starts off with a verse I really want you to think about. And a lot of this is going to be kind of review. A lot of this is something that we've heard before. But I want you to really follow with me as together this morning we kind of get back on task and kind of revisit why we are here as a church. 1 Corinthians 15, 34 says this: "Awake to righteousness and do not sin. For some do not have the knowledge of God, and I speak this to your shame." Let me read that again. "Awake to righteousness and do not sin. For some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame." You know, let's pray together this morning. Most holy God, I just thank you for this time we have together. And Lord, this privilege to open your word and for you to challenge us through your word. And God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for each person that's here. And Lord, we just thank you for this family and this atmosphere that we get to experience every week. And Lord, I'm just kind of heartbroken that there are people in our community and people who we work with and people who we do life with who don't get to experience what we get to experience every week of what it means to be connected to you and what it means to be connected to each other. Lord, I just pray that you'd help us to wake up. I pray you'd help us to see clearly, Lord Jesus, the mission that you set before us. And I pray that you give us wisdom and the vision and the boldness and the courage, Lord, to do what you would have us to do in your community. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I love this verse because it starts off and it says, wake up. Because sometimes we need that. I know this morning when my alarm went off, I was thinking, wow, I cannot believe it's already time to get up. You know, it was just crazy. But wake to righteousness and do not sin. But he says, why is he saying wake up? He said, because there are some people who don't have the knowledge of God. And he goes a step further. He says, I speak this to your shame. The mission has been given to us to tell people about Jesus, to show him in our lives, to show him through our actions. And it's time for us to wake up and do that. And I don't want to ever get to the place where we forget the reason that we exist as a church. Mark chapter 16 and verse 15 says this. It's the great command that Jesus gave, the last command that he gave us. And he said this, and he said, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Go into all the world and tell everybody about the gospel. What's the gospel? The gospel is that Jesus Christ was buried, that he died, that he was buried, that he rose again on the third day. That's the gospel. And that he died for our sins according to Scripture. That's the gospel. He says it's our job to go to our world and make sure that everybody has an opportunity to hear this. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20. Says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. So as Jesus kind of lays down our purpose, we talk about what's our purpose, why we're here. We are here to be a light in our community. We are here to let people know Jesus and know who he is and what it means. Because the reality is that our world needs Jesus. Our world needs Jesus, and we need to never forget that. We all need a salvation that's freely offered in Christ. If you read, you know, Romans 3:23 and 6:23 and 5:8 and 10:9 and 10, we see that we're reminded of something that we know. We're reminded that we're all broken, that we've all sinned, and we've all fallen short of God. There's not a person who's been born who does not fall into that category because it says we're all that way. And we didn't really need that verse to tell us that. Because we know that we're broken. We know that we don't always do the right thing. In fact, we know that there's this inclination inside of us to sometimes make poor decisions and poor choices. And the Bible calls that a sin nature. It's something that we're born with. And Romans 6:23 tells us that we don't deserve heaven because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. God sent his Son to die on the cross to offer us a gift of forgiveness, of grace, and of a relationship with him. And that is important, and that is powerful. And Romans 5:8 says that God showed his love for us, and while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus died on the cross for us, took our punishment, and died for our sins so we could experience the life we're experiencing today. But he doesn't want just us to experience it. He wants our world, he wants our community to experience that as well. Romans 10, 9 and 10 tells us we have to accept it. We have to make a decision to make Jesus Christ the Lord of our life. We have to believe in our hearts God raised him from the dead, confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and this amazing thing happened. God saves us and he changes us. And that is why we're here as a church. It's about change. It's about action. It's not about understanding a set of rules or beliefs. It's about something so much more than that and so much deeper than that. It's about us becoming the ones that God created us to be. And so he tells us that we need to be saved. And he says, teach all nations, tell them about Jesus. And he says that we need to be baptized. And Acts 2:41 says that this first church, Peter stands up and preaches a sermon on the day of Pentecost. And thousands of people come to Christ. These are people that he's preaching to who many of them were probably there yelling, crucify him when Jesus was crucified. And they hear the message of the gospel and their lives are changed. And they gladly receive his word. They accept him as their Lord and Savior. And they were baptized and 3,000 souls were added to them on that day. So that's our mission. Our mission is to tell people about Christ. Our mission is to disciple them. Our mission is to lead them into baptism, to follow Jesus' command, to be in obedience to him. That's our mission. And our world needs Jesus. But to fulfill Jesus' command to reach our world, we have to realize a couple of things. And the first one is this, is that it's not about me, it's about serving others. How many times have you heard this over the past year? I've jokingly said to some people that I basically have preached the same sermon every Sunday for the past year, just changed it up a little bit. Why? Because we want to drive home the fact that church is not a place to come and sit. It's a place to go and serve. It's a place to come and to be an encouragement to each other. It's a place to come and get recharged. It's a place for us to come and worship and praise. But this is all, every description that you hear of Christianity, you're going to see a verb involved because there is action involved with our Christianity. And he tells us that it's about serving others. This morning, I want to focus on 1 Corinthians chapter 9. I love this passage of Scripture. It's this passage where Paul is kind of explaining why he does what he does. Paul is explaining how he takes that task, that mission that Jesus Christ has given us, and how does he accomplish that task? How does he accomplish that mission? So he starts off in verse 19, and he says this. He says, "For though I'm free from all men, I've made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. For though I'm free from all men, I've made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more." It's kind of interesting. Paul said that whenever he accepted Christ, he was set free. I mean, that's the really cool thing about Christianity. It's freedom. It's grace. It's a lot of awesome things. But he said, though I'm free from all men, I commit in my life to be a servant. Not just a servant to other believers, not just a servant to my family, not just a servant to my friends, but a servant to all. And he said, why would I do that? I mean, who wants to be a servant? Who wants to be the person that's just kind of on their knees or helping or doing all the tasks or just doing the things that need to be done? Who wants to be that guy? We have this idea in our society that we don't want to be the servant, we want to be the master. But the thing is, when we became believers, we gave that role of master to somebody else. We said, Jesus, you're my Lord. Jesus, you're my master. So if you're my master, that makes me the servant, right? So I'm going to be a servant. And if Jesus Christ can say in Mark 10:45, I didn't come to serve, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. If Jesus Christ can kneel down and wash people's feet as an example of what it looks like for us to serve others, then we need to figure that out. We need to serve as well. So he tells us, I am a servant to all. I will serve everybody. I don't have to serve others, but I choose to so they can see Jesus in me. So they can see Jesus in me. There are a lot of ways to serve. One of the things that I am trying to do, and as a church, we're trying to do in our leadership, is to provide opportunities for service. Because I'm convinced that there are many, many of us would like to get involved, and we're just not sure how to do that. How do I get involved? How do I serve? And that's one reason why we started the food ministry. It was for multiple reasons. For one reason, it was people have needs, and we have this ability to meet their needs by giving them food on Saturdays. The bigger reason, people need Christ, and it gives us the opportunity to build relationships. But the other reason was this, was that something happens when we get up out of our comfort zone and we go out and begin to serve others. It's not only good for them, but man, I want to tell you something. I love Saturdays, and I love the things that we get to do to be able to help serve each other, because you go to be a blessing to somebody else, and you wind up so much more blessed than the people you're trying to help. It's just an amazing thing. It's the way God created us, right? I don't have to serve others, but I choose to, so they can see Jesus in me. That's one of the reasons why when Legacy said that they were going to discontinue their involvement with Upward, you know, they asked if we would be interested in picking that up. We said, yeah, all right. I want to tell you something. That's a scary yeah for a pastor to say, right? Because they were providing a lot of help and a lot of resources involved with the Upward Soccer League. But I thought, you know what, God, I'm praying for you to just, if you open the door and you bring something our way, we're going to step through it. And then somebody, I'm praying that, and somebody says, hey, you want to take over Upward Soccer? Okay, you know. But I'm looking around, I'm thinking, okay, we need coaches, we need refs, we need assistant coaches, we need families that will sponsor teams. Not financially, but in prayer and just in friendship to sponsor teams. And I thought, okay, God, this is maybe something that you're going to use in our church to draw people in to serve so that they can see Jesus in us, so that they can understand the purpose of the Great Commission of Jesus in their lives. So that's why we're doing Upward. And if you're able to help with that, I'm going to keep asking and I'm going to keep praying that you would step outside your comfort zone and do that. You say, well, I don't know anything about soccer. Well, neither do I. I've never played soccer really in my life, right? I've played, you know, just messing around, but I've never played on a soccer team. I don't know anything about it, but I can watch a video and I know how to read and I can do what somebody tells me to do. And so there are people who have experience with this. One of the big things I want to emphasize in our Upward Soccer League this year is that I want to emphasize that there is somebody on each team that can take spiritual leadership of the team. You may not understand the rules of soccer. You may not know how to coach. That's okay. We can find somebody to help coach, right? But I need somebody on the team at halftime to lead devotions, or in the break during the practices to lead devotions. So I don't know how to lead devotions. Like, they give you a little sheet and you read it to the kids, right? And if you really want to put some time into it, read it ahead of time so you kind of know what it is. And you can ad lib on that a little bit, but they make it very easy. Everything's planned. Everything's programmed. It's an awesome program. But I need somebody on each team that will take some spiritual leadership, that will lead a team in prayer. And that, you don't have to be the coach. You can be the assistant coach. You can be the guy who go gets the ball when it goes out of bounds. Doesn't matter, right? We're not here to be in a position. We're here to serve. And so we're doing things like Upward Soccer. We're doing things like the food ministry. We need Sunday school teachers. We need people to help in the nursery. All of those things are opportunities for us to serve so people can see Jesus in us. So to fulfill Jesus' command to reach our world, we've got to realize it's not about me. It's about serving others. The next thing we have to realize is this. I've got to focus on what we have in common instead of how different we are. You know, as you look around in our auditorium, you're going to find people from many different places in our community, different places financially, different places as far as age, differences. We can focus on all of our differences. But Paul said this. He said, I'm going to focus on what we have in common instead of how we are different. He basically is saying, I'm going to take the time to get to know someone so I can understand where they're coming from. That's why we do the food ministry. I realize that I can go up and I can knock on a door at somebody's house and say, do you know Jesus? Jesus loves you, and so do I. Will you accept him as your Lord and Savior? And they're probably going to close the door because I can tell you they will oftentimes because I've done that, right? And that sometimes it happens. But it's kind of crazy. We've been doing this every Saturday for just about a year, not quite a year now. And yesterday, this thing happened that I began to think about later, and it was kind of weird. When we first went to the park, people could not figure us out. And I don't blame them, right? You know, I was the guy who, when cars were driving by and nobody was stopping, I'm flagging them down. I'm waving at them. I'm coming doing this. You know, I'm going free food, you know, whatever. I'm knocking, they're rolling their windows down. You know, they were all nervous about it. Yesterday, we were waiting. We were done. The trailer was loaded, and we were waiting. Two or three cars drove by. I didn't know anybody in the cars. I didn't recognize them as ever having come up, and they all waved to me. Not just to me. Barry was standing there, a few other people. People who a year ago were driving by and were afraid to look at us, purposely would not look over there at all this craziness going on over here, right? They're waving to us now. Word has gotten around in that community, and they appreciate what we're trying to do. We're breaking down barriers. We're focusing on what we have in common instead of how we are different. And Paul said, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to take the time to get to know someone so I can understand where they're coming from. 1 Corinthians 9:20, Paul continues, and he says, to the Jews, I became as a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without the law, without law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ. But I'm doing this that I might win those who are without law. You see, Paul recognized that we must remove the obstacles of our differences so people can relate to us. I mean, this is really important, especially with what we're talking about this morning. Paul recognized that we must remove the obstacles of our differences so people can relate to us. When Paul was talking to the Jews, he went to the synagogue. When Paul was talking to the Jews, he emphasized his Jewishness. When Paul was talking to the Jews, he went to the Old Testament and showed them from the Old Testament scriptures as he stood in the synagogue, as he said, I've been where you are, and he shared Christ with them. But you see him later standing on Mars Hill talking to a group of Romans. And this group of Romans were basically, they worshiped the gods, right? And he stood up and they loved to stand and debate and do a lot of philosophy. So he stood up and he began to talk to them on their level and in their way. Completely different group. He approached them in a completely different way, but with the same message. And we've got to learn to do that as well. 1 Corinthians 9:22 says this. He says, to the weak I became as weak that I might win the weak. And I love this last phrase. It says, I have become all things to all men that I might by all means save some. Really, can we read that? I've become all things to all men that I might by all means save some. That's our purpose. That's our purpose. I'm going to find a way to make somebody I'm talking to feel comfortable. Not being deceitful, genuine. You genuinely want to build that relationship so that we can have an opportunity to share something with them that will change their lives. As we began the journey to refocus our church, we started it off by asking ourselves questions. Why are we here? What's our mission? What's our purpose? And so we had a lot of thoughts and discussions about that. And after much discussion, our purpose, our mission was this. At least our mission was to know Jesus and make him known while living, loving, and serving like him. That's a pretty good summary of what we're here for as a church, isn't it? To know Jesus and make him known while living, loving, and serving like him. And we looked at our purpose. We began to narrow it all down, and it basically came down to five E's, just so it's easy to remember. We're here to exalt our God. We're here to worship, right? We're here to evangelize, to tell people about Jesus. We're here to equip believers to serve, to make disciples, right? So our job is not to necessarily go out and to win everybody to Christ or to help everybody grow in Christ, my job in particular. My job is to equip you to do that because together we'll do much more than I can ever do on my own. So it's to equip. And then our job is to engage. We can have all this knowledge and have all this love for God and all this stuff and experience this amazing life, But if we never engage and tell people about it and serve others, you know, we're missing out on a big part of our purpose. And then we're here to encourage, to spend time together. You've probably noticed some changes over the past year and a half, 2 years, as we've tried to revalue what we're doing and why we're doing it. A year ago, I sat down and I remember I was looking at some sermons I preached a year ago, and I said, as we focus more on our community, we're gonna be working toward creating an environment where people who are searching can feel comfortable, and it's gonna make some changes. And we have made some changes, and we have gotten more involved. We're getting up out of our seats. We're going into our community, and I love that. But the reality is if we stay where we are, we die, right? We have to be alive. There has to be action. There has to be activity for our Lord Jesus Christ. It's important. We are here to fulfill our mission, and we decided that nothing is sacred, that nothing is sacred. If we look at that, if we're participating in activity that is not centered around the mission of knowing Jesus and making him known, well, living, loving, and serving like him, we're going to stop that activity. If we see an activity, an opportunity to get involved and serve, where we could do that, then that's something we're going to give consideration to. Jesus Christ said that I came in Luke 19:10 to seek and to save those who are lost. Right? That's our reason. That's our purpose for being here. And we are going to be a mission-focused church. If we say this is our purpose, to know Jesus and make him known while living, loving, and serving like him, then we are going to fulfill that mission, and that's going to be our purpose, and we're going to revisit everything in light of that. We don't want to keep doing anything just because it's always been done that way. We're not interested in busyness and doing things just to stay busy. We're all busy enough, right? There are a lot of good things we can do, but it's something like the food ministry. If the food ministry turns into just going up and giving people food on Saturdays, don't misunderstand me. That's a good thing. But that is not the primary mission of our church. The primary mission of our church is to know Jesus and make him known. And I'm going to make him known by meeting their needs, by serving them, by giving them food. I'm going to build relationships to open doors so they can experience and come to know Christ, right? Because we're a mission-focused church. Upward Soccer. I'm very excited about it. It's going to be a great ministry. It's for a fairly short period of time. I think there are only 6 games, you know, and there's practices before that. But, you know, it's not like a long thing that we're doing. But if Upward Soccer becomes just another community soccer league, then we'll stop because we don't need another community soccer league. That's not the purpose of our church. Our purpose of our church is to tell our community about Christ. Our purpose as a church is to remove obstacles that would prevent people from doing that, to break down barriers. Over the past several years, I've been increasingly giving consideration to whether or not the name of our church is a help or a hindrance to fulfill our mission. I've noticed a subtle shift in people's perception of denominations in general and in our community in particular. Our world is changing. And it's difficult for us to grasp. We like things to remain the same. But the reality is that our world is changing. We live in a generation that's different than previous generations. You've heard the phrase generation gap, right? And we all know what that means. It means that there comes a place to where this generation is having difficulty relating to this generation, which means this generation is having the same difficulty relating to that generation. And we've all experienced that. We've all experienced what it's like. You know, it's sometimes like showing somebody who, you know, your grandma or grandpa how to use their mobile phone. You know, you know, that's why we have kids, so they can tell us and show us how to do stuff, right? But those things are real. You know, you got to realize that there are people in our church who grew up who did not have computers when they were growing up. They actually went to the library. They experience these things like we were talking about several weeks ago. Rob was talking about card catalogs. You remember? They experienced all of these things. And if you wanted to do a report, you had to go to the library. You couldn't even bring home the encyclopedia. You had to actually leave it there. You could maybe copy it, but you had to do all of your work there. It was a different world. And now then, you can find out anything you want to do. Yesterday, it's embarrassing, we helped Debbie Sandler move. And a friend of mine is a rep, a sales rep, and he gave me these straps, but they weren't straps, they were ropes and it was kind of a weird kind of configuration, and they needed a strap. I said, yeah, I've got some in my trunk. So I went and I got them, and didn't have the slightest idea how to use it. I had no idea. I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, something's just not right. I get this side, I don't understand this side, Jack says, let's YouTube it. So we YouTubed it, first video. These are so easy to use. I'm like, oh, man, that makes me feel really dumb, you know. But come to find out, there was a piece missing off of it. You know, and I went there, dug in the bag, there it was, you know. Oh, now it makes sense. But that's the world that we live in, instant information. Everything's there. And unfortunately, if we decide that we're not going to ever use a computer, if we decide that we're never going to use a cell phone, if we decide that we're not going to do that, you can live your life that way, but you're going to become irrelevant to the previous, to the next generation. There is going to be a gap between us and the next generation. Many people at work struggle because there are a lot of changes. You have to do this, and there are a lot of things. Everything's, you know, internet-based, everything, all the software and all the things that we're having to do now. And I know that many of you can relate. You know, it's a struggle. We have to keep up. We have to keep up to become relevant. You know, most of your kids probably don't write checks. Many of our kids have probably never written a check. That's why would they do that? I mean, they can just go online and pay their bills, and it's easy. Why would they go to the bank to deposit a check? You have to talk to people, right? Who wants to do that, right? You have to stand in line. You have to go someplace. You can just take a picture of it, the front, take a picture of the back, and it's there. You owe somebody money, you don't have to reach into your wallet and send them money. You just Venmo or you Zelle it. You send it over to them because that's the world that they live in. And we've got to understand that they live in a different world than perhaps we grew up in. And this shift is subtle, but it's happening, and it is here. And if we're unwilling to change, we'll be left behind in our workplaces. And if we're unwilling to adapt to a changing world, then our church will become irrelevant. We have to adapt to the world and what it is. So I began to ask myself a question as I'm thinking about this idea of a name change. Who are we trying to reach? As I began to refocus, I could quickly answer that it's people who don't know Christ. That's our goal. That's what we've looked at. That's what we all sat down and decided. Our goal is to reach people who don't know Christ. Our goal and our responsibility is to reach the next generation so that they can reach the next generation, so they can reach the next generation. If that breaks down, it's catastrophe, right? We as a church have to be open to do that. So I began to ask myself a question. Is our name of our church a help or is it a hindrance in making that happen? And so I began to look and began to research. And interesting, according to a recent study, churches with a denominational reference in their name versus none. Now look at these. This is kind of scary, but it's the reality. Three times more likely to be perceived as formal. Three times more likely to be perceived as old-fashioned. Three times more likely to be perceived as structured and rigid, and are perceived to be less welcoming to visitors. That's not what I want our church to be. You know, today we're voting on a name change for our church. And when you see the name Baptist on a sign, it means something to you. To many of you, that means something. And what you may not realize is that the denominational name on our sign may mean something completely different to you than it means to your neighbor or the person sitting next to you. To many of us, the word Baptist defines who we are. It means it's our beliefs. It's what we represent and who we are. And this is precious to us. You know, just to name a few, we believe the scriptures, both Old Testament, Old and New Testament, to be the inspired word of God, the complete revelation of his will for the salvation of men, and the divine and final authority for all Christian faith and life. We believe in one God, creator of all things, infinitely perfect and eternally existing in three persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe that man was created in the image of God, but fell into sin and is therefore lost. We believe that the only ground for justification and salvation is through faith alone in the shed blood of Jesus Christ and his resurrection, and that salvation is wholly of God's grace. We believe that the command to give the gospel to the world is clear and unmistakable, and this commission was given to the churches. There are a whole list. Those are the things that we believe. And to many of you, that is what you think when you hear the word Baptist. The reality is that the world we live in has a different perception of what that word means than what it means to us. To our current generation, the word Baptist means something different. Tom Rainer, who is the president of Lifeway Resources at the Southern Baptist Convention, did a survey, and it was kind of interesting. In the survey, they asked the question, what comes to your mind when you hear the word Baptist? What comes to your mind when you hear the word Baptist? Now, this is the Southern Baptist Convention who is sponsoring the survey. And I want you to listen to some of the words. Some of the words I think are awesome. immersion, Bible, Southern, conservative, sound theologically, missions, you know, inerrancy of the Bible. Those things are awesome. But I want you to listen to the things that made the list of the top 20-ish things that came up in the survey. Number one, perception in the survey said the first word they think is legalism. Is it true? I don't think so in our church. But does it matter if it's true, if that's what they think? Number two, potluck. Nailed it, right? Gotta say, they nailed it, right? That's exactly right. Number five, traditional. Number seven, outdated. Number nine, boring. Number 13, hymns. Number 14, suits and ties. A little bit below the list of top 15, fighting, business meetings, men only. That's what the survey said. Not all those things are bad, but taken together, it's collectively, it's a perception that we don't want to project. You say, well, Pastor Doug, that's not what I think it is. I agree with you, it's not what I think it is either. But according to this survey done by the Southern Baptist Convention, that is what the world we live in thinks. And I think that's unfortunate. But it's not what I think because that's irrelevant. It's what the people we're trying to reach thinks. It is what the community we're trying to reach thinks. When perception meets reality, perception will win out every time. And if you don't believe that, watch your TV whenever election time comes. They don't care about truth in their advertising that they do. It's about perception. If they can give you the perception or make you have the perception that they are one thing, that's what they're shooting for. It may not be right, it may not be true, they don't care, right? Because perceptions win elections. I read an article last summer that truly convicted me because this is something that's been on my mind for a long time. And in that article, it was a Pew Research poll, and it said this. And will you read this with me and read what it's saying? It says 25% of Americans who believe in God but don't attend church would never attend a church with a denominational affiliation in the church name. I think that's sad, but it's also scary. 25% of Americans who believe in God but don't attend church would never attend a church with a denominational affiliation in the church name. Put that another way. One in four people that we are trying to reach are not going to walk in these doors because of a word on the sign. Can I say that again? One in four people who we are trying to reach are not going to walk into these doors because of a name on that sign. Perhaps this is why 90% of the churches in the top 100 largest and fastest growing churches do not have a denominational affiliation in their name anymore. So we have to determine our mission and our target audience. If we as a church decide that it's our mission to reach more Baptists, then we need to keep Baptists in the name. Changing our name, one of the negatives to changing our name is if somebody moves to our community and they're Baptist and they're looking for a church home, we would not be the most obvious choice. If they look at our statement of faith, they're going to see exactly what they're looking for. But seeing based on the sign, that would not be their first choice. But if our mission is to reach people in our community who don't know Jesus, then we need to rethink whether or not we should have Baptist in our name. We've got to determine whether the denominational affiliation is a wall or a bridge. In some parts of the country, it's a bridge. You know, there you would want Baptist in big, bold letters on your sign. In others, it's a wall. And I think in our area, it's become more of a wall than a bridge. I ask people to come to church, and it's so frustrating to me. Say, hey, why don't you come to church this Sunday? I'm not Baptist. I don't care. You know, come to church. We just love Jesus, right? Many people will not come if they were not raised in that church. This isn't hypothetical. I'm going to put a couple of people on the spot. But I learned some things this past week that I didn't even know. Last week, Angie shared her story and sent me an email and to kind of give me the rest of the story. You know, Angie came to Christ on her own through reading her Bible, and and we connected over the internet, and she was asking questions and wanted to get baptized. And I said, absolutely. She said, would you baptize me? I said, absolutely. We'd love to do that. And so we set up a time for her to get baptized. What I didn't realize is that Angie just lives a few minutes down the road. Angie drives past our church every Sunday, every day, a couple times a day. And she realized that this Baptist church, that we were the Baptist church, but she didn't realize that I was the pastor of that Baptist church when she was talking to me. And then she drove past the church and realized, uh-oh, I called the Baptist guy. Oh, what am I going to do now, right? And she said, I didn't feel right. It would be right to cancel. So she came on. And she said she was just so frustrated with the whole denominational thing. You know, she just was so frustrated with it. And it's sad to me to think that had Angie not forgotten that we were that church, right? That she wouldn't be sitting here today. Because she's a blessing. And we love her. But then Sonia shared with Sue a similar experience. Reluctance because of their perception of what the name on the sign said. Can you imagine a church without Ben and Sonia? I can't. What a blessing it is. I've been talking to everybody because that's what I do, you know. And what's your perception on this? And I found that the younger generation has basically come out and said, we don't like names with denominations in them. We think it's divisive. Now, to us, it means something different. To them, that's what they think, though. The reality is that since, as a church, our mission is this, to know Jesus and make him known while living, loving, and serving him. If we're going to know him and make him known, then we've got to realize that that's our thing. Since our target audience is people who don't know Jesus, and since we want to remove obstacles from people coming to Christ, after much prayer and deliberation, the leadership of our church has proposed that we change the name of our church, and the new name they're proposing is Crosby Community Church. So that's kind of what we're thinking, Crosby Community Church. I understand that for some people that might be a little bit unsettling, and I'm going to tell you a little bit that's unsettling for me too. You say, you know what, Pastor Doug, this has been my church, and that name means something to me. And I want to tell you personally that I can relate to you. Sue and I named the church, right? So nobody's more invested in the name of the church than Sue and I are. When we sat down and we started this church, this was something that we wanted to portray. But as we stepped back and as we looked, we said, what is our purpose? We don't want someone's perception of who we are to affect whether or not they'll pull into this parking lot. We don't want somebody's perception of who we are to affect whether or not they're going to listen to the message of the cross at our church. Now, it's important to understand, changing our name does not change who we are. Please understand that. So let's look at the name and explain kind of why we went this direction. Before we do that, let's understand this. Changing our name, we're not going to change one word in our statement of faith. We're not going to change one thing. I'm not going to change one thing in the way I preach. It's disappointing for some, exciting for others. We're not going to change our mission. We're not going to change our purpose. And you aren't going to change who you are. We're removing a name that has become an obstacle to people in our community to coming to Christ. So with that in mind, the reality is that we're not the only Baptist church to reach this conclusion. You know, as you look to Southern Baptist Convention, most new churches in the SBC don't have denominational affiliation in their church names. Think about all the churches in our city that don't have denominational affiliations. Are they really non-denominational? Their pastors graduated from denominational colleges, Bible colleges and seminaries. Why is that? Because they don't want a denominational name to be an obstacle to reaching people for Christ. The reality is that our world is changing. And as a church, we have to stay relevant and relatable without watering down our doctrine and without compromising our message. So, why Crosby Community Church? First, Crosby tells people where we are, right? One of the biggest frustrations I have when I go out and talk to people, especially people from Parks of Whitewater or over here at the food ministry, they are literally blocks from our church and they have no idea we're even here. They have no idea where Edgewood Road is. If everybody knew where Edgewood Road was, I'd think about naming our word Edgewood Road something church, you know? So people would know where we are. Nobody knows where Edgewood Road is. I've tried everywhere in the world to explain to them. I've said, okay, you know where the Baptist Cemetery is, that old cemetery? No. Do you know where? So I finally figured out at the trailer park that they know where the mini mart is up here. So I tell them from the mini mart, but they still, once you say to turn left, they just get kind of lost. They get this vacant look in their eyes. And I finally figured out that most of them know where Short Road is. I said, so go to Short Road, go straight. Well, turn a little, then go straight, you know. I said, that's Edgewood. I said, we're just about a mile down on the right. And they go, oh, but they don't know we're here. The word Crosby tells people, at least, that we're a Crosby Township, right? That's where we are. That's where we're located. And the reality is that we have been praying a lot for people, the communities in our area. This is the community where our church is. If you look around over here out the windows, and I saw you doing that earlier, if you look out the windows, and before long, you can see houses surrounding us all the way around us. If you look out the back, what used to be farmland is now houses. You can see across the back working its way back around us. It's gonna happen. We're going to be in the middle of a community. And the community we're going to be in the middle of is Crosby. And the thing about Crosby is Crosby's a tight community. So if we're going to start where we are and work our way out, our primary focus is going to be to reach Crosby. Not that we don't love other areas and other communities, but in reality, this is where we're located. We'll start here. We'll work our way out. So if we're praying for Parks of Whitewater, if we're praying for Haven West, if we're praying for Whitewater Trails, if we're praying for Villages of Whitewater, if we're praying for Fort Scott, if we're praying for it, that's all Crosby Township, right? And so Crosby tells us where we are. It's the closest proximity to our church, and we can basically tell people we are a church in the community for your community. Now, is anybody going to get all worked up if they live in Harrison that we named our church Crosby? I don't think so. I can't see them really caring, truthfully, all right? Our goal is just to give an idea of where we are and to be able to relate to the community that we live in. If we become a mega church, we can take Crosby off, all right? So we can do that, all right? So that's Crosby. The next thing is community. Community maintains our identity. We refer to ourselves as community. We're still going to refer to, hey, welcome to community. We're glad you came here to worship with us today. It's continuity for who we are, right? It maintains our identity. We're a church in the community for the community. It reminds us that we're a community. It reminds us that we're a family. The other thing that you see emphasized in this that I really like is the word unity. And as you look at the word unity, it reminds us, while we may have many differences, we're going to focus on what we have in common. Exactly what 1 Corinthians 9 was talking about. Jesus said something pretty powerful that sometimes we overlook. But he said that the world will believe that he is Lord when they see the church is one. And so that's one thing our church has always, I feel like, has always been. We've been one. We're close. We're a family. We want to invite other people into our family to welcome that, and we welcome that, right? And the last thing is church. Crosby Community Church. The emphasis on church. Church defines what we are. Jesus said, I'm going to build my rock of the confession that I'm the Christ. I'm going to build the church. I will build the church. The gates of hell won't prevail against it. And Jesus said that he loves the church. So Crosby Community Church. That's the reason why we've kind of gone that direction. Now, actually the color is, this is blue, right? If you look back at that monitor, it's a little bit of a different color, a little bit more of a greenish blue, a little bit darker color. That's kind of more the color we're actually looking at. But if you look at this, this is what we are. Now, what would that look like in use? So let's look at the next screen. On a website, it would be Crosby Community Church, something like that. A sign, not necessarily that sign, but something similar to that. T-shirts, we're looking at what would it look like on a coffee cup or just different things. That's kind of what it would look like in use. I think it looks pretty awesome, and I think it's pretty cool. Everybody that I've shown, people at the Coffee Peddler all know me now, right? Because I think that a lot of people hanging out at the Coffee Peddler are pretty cool people, right? And I've asked their opinions. You don't know me, but what do you think about this? You know, hey, you know my daughter. You know, they're like, okay, why is this guy talking to me? You know, and I've asked them. You know, we've looked at many different options in many different directions. Everybody, almost without exception, has gravitated to this. Again, slightly different color than what's showing up on our monitor. It's not a light blue. It's more of a darker color. And I can show you some actual in print afterwards if you have questions. But that's kind of what we're looking at. So that's why we're here. Our focus, we're here to refocus. And as a church, we've got to be willing to adapt our culture to fulfill the Great Commission. Let's read 1 Corinthians 9 and sum it up. We're done. For though I'm free from all men, I've made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. To the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, it was without law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law. To the weak, I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I just want to thank you for our time together. I just pray that together as a church, you'd help us just to refocus and to just be just on point, Lord, with why we're here and why we exist. I just pray, Lord, that you would just give us wisdom, Lord, in this year coming up, Lord, to be able to reach out and serve you. Just ask God that you would just help us to remove obstacles so that we can reach our community for you. God, we love you. I thank you for each person that's here. And I just pray that you bless our day, bless our meeting that's going to follow our service. I thank you, Lord, that we've been a church that has been a true community. I thank you that we've been a church that has represented unity and that we've been one. And I just pray that would just continue. And Lord, I just pray that our friends in the world around us, that they could come and experience what we get to experience, not just here, but in life, what it means to have you as our Savior, to be forgiven. So Lord, I just pray that you bless our service. Help each of us, Lord, to begin to think about what can I do and how can I serve to be more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. I can invite you to stand just in attitude of prayer. Become all things to all men, that might by all means save some. What are you willing to do to see people come to Christ? Who are you willing to talk with? How are you willing to present yourself so that you don't seem better than somebody or not as good as somebody? Or are you willing to try to find ways to relate and become friends with a world who needs Jesus? Paul said that's how we accomplish our mission. So pray for us that we would just not that we'd be able to fulfill the mission that he's given us as a church. This time's for you. If God's speaking to your heart, if there's something specific that you'd like to pray about, if you just say, God, you know, I want to step outside my comfort zone, I want to do more, then give it to God this morning. ask God to show you ways that you can serve. And just watch and see as he begins to open those doors and provide those opportunities. I was praying it, and God gave me upper sock. Right? You pray it, and you may get something completely different. But God, I'm sure, will find a way for you to be used. As the music plays, this time's for you.
Lord, I thank you that our identity is not found in what we say we are, but what you say we are.
Now he'll feast at the table of the Lord. And I won't hunger anymore at his table.
See, he'll feast.
And now he'll feast at the table of my Lord. And now he'll feast at my love. Oh, and I won't hunger anymore at your table. Oh, come on, you weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, his burden light. He is able, he will restore at the table of my Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord.
Father, Lord, I thank you for our time together this morning, for what it means to be here. Lord, our prayer, our heartfelt prayer, Lord, is that you would bless your church, this church, Lord. Lord, that you would just give us that tremendous honor and privilege of being able to use to love others in your name, to fulfill the mission that you've given us, to love people and just tell them about you. And watch and see what you do in their lives. So God, meet the needs of our community. Meet the needs here in our church in the way that you and you alone can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks and be seated. Thank you so much. I was telling Kim and Matt back there in the sound room that